Today we're going to be talking about the short story slash poem Brilliant Silence by Spencer Holst. Now I said poem slash short story because in reality the definition of what this is up for question. It's short enough that it's not really considered to be a short story. You might classify it as a work of flash fiction or even a postcard story, but on the other hand, the lyrical qualities of this text certainly place it within the realm of poetry. So I'm going to be referring throughout this lecture to this work of literature as a poem, and what I specifically mean is a prose poem. So we're going to be looking at three specific literary devices in the explication of this poem. We're going to be starting off by looking at inclusio, we're going to move on to alliteration, then we're going to finish with a rhetorical question that occurs at the very end of the poem. Now inclusio, an inclusiastic structure is typically seen in poetry. That's one of the reasons I'm calling this a poem, because we don't often find it in other works, such as short stories, especially not to the degree that we see it in this poem. So the phrase, paw in paw, stepping in unison, is a trigger for us, because it occurs both at the beginning of the text and the end of the text. This rhetorical repetition alerts us to the fact that something interesting is happening within this poem. It's not just a story. There's something more to its structure. So on the board here, I've got this structure. At the very beginning and very end, we see the bears dancing in the circus. Then we see the bears that are dancing by themselves. Then next, the second and second last elements we see in the structure, we've got the bears who are abandoned by humans. And then at the very end, the bears who are rediscovered by humans, by the scientists. And then in the middle, we have these bears who are fruitful and multiply. So this is the plot of this poem. We've got these bears, and they're in this circus, and they're taught circus tricks. All of a sudden, a jaguar jumped the juggler, and afterwards, mortally mauled the animal trainer, and the shocked show people disbanded in dismay and horror, at which point the bears go on to live by themselves on this deserted island. Now, many years have passed. The bears are fruitful and they multiply, which is the middle section of our inclusiastic structure here. And then they're rediscovered by scientists who discover that they're still dancing. And at the very end of the story, they are dancing not in the circus, but they are dancing by themselves, and one would argue they're dancing for themselves. So this structure is supposed to show us a bit of the poet's playfulness. Now, we're seeing the bears dancing in the circus, we're seeing the bears dancing by the crater. I mean, the entire plot of this little poem has playfulness to it. I mean, the idea of bears who are dancing and who continue to dance after their masters, after the humans have gone. I mean, this indicates to us that these bears are fun-loving creatures, that they're playful. And this playfulness in structure, in the inclusiastic structure, is also met in the alliteration that we find in the second paragraph, which I just read. Let me read it again. There a jaguar jumped the juggler, and afterwards mortally mauled the animal trainer, and the shocked show people disbanded in dismay and horror. Now, in works of literature, we sometimes see two words that are put side by side that share the same first letter. This is a case of what I would call accidental alliteration. See what I did there? Accidental alliteration that alliterates. Yeah, okay, nobody's got it. Fine. So, accidental alliteration. We find this all the time. And students are sometimes tempted to say, oh, this is alliteration, this is it. But in reality, it was just an accident. The author wanted to use this word and that word for very different reasons. They get put together, their scene's alliteration. But in this text, in that line, in the turning point in the story, we have not just one case of alliteration, but five. Jaguar jumped juggler, and afterwards, mortally mauled, shocked show people, disbanded in dismay. Five instances in the same sentence. This should indicate to us that the poet is not accidentally smushing these words together, that this is indeed on purpose. So whereas before we saw this playfulness in structure, with the poet creating this inclusiastic structure on purpose, here we have playfulness with language. The poet is playing with the language. Instead of saying, there a jaguar attacked the sky who puts the sword down his throat, instead of saying that, it's jaguar jumped juggler. There's many different positions in circus. There's many different creatures in the wild. There's many different verbs that could be used. But by picking these specific three, we know that he's doing something purposeful here. And because we've already got this very fanciful story about these bears who are dancing by themselves, we know that something playful is going on, not only in the structure, but in this instance of alliteration. And finally, at the very end of the poem, let me read this final stanza. Paw and paw step in unison. What music could they possibly hear inside their heads as they dance under the full moon and the Aurora Australis, as they dance in brilliant silence? The Aurora Borealis, its sister. So we've got this rhetorical question at the very end. What music could the bears possibly hear as they are dancing with the full moon and as they are illuminated in this crater and as they see the aurora lights above them? What silence could they possibly hear? What music could they possibly hear? And in fact, it's a rhetorical question because there is no music. There's nothing heard. The bears are dancing to the sound of what they see. And that doesn't make any sense. We can't hear sight. We can't hear the moon. We can't hear the Aurora Borealis. What this poet is doing is something called synesthesia. Synesthesia is a mixing, a combining of the senses. I taste yellow. You can't taste yellow, right? But this is a synesthetic concept. Some people, synesthetes, can actually taste colors. They can actually hear what the sun sounds like. Their senses are confused. It's a medical condition. But for people who have it, it's a blessing. For poets who have it, it's an even greater blessing. But anyway, we've got this confusion at the end of the senses. The bears cannot hear music. They can only see the beauty around them, and they must dance to it. This is a rhetorical question. What music are they listening to? Well, they're not. But by ending this particular poem with a question, it forces us to go back into the poem and say, well, what's the answer to this? Same thing with the structure. The fact that we see paw and paw stepping in unison at the beginning and at the end forces us to go back into the poem to look for more elements into the structure. But getting back to the rhetorical question at the very end, I mean, the answer is there's no music. It's only the beauty that we see around us, that they see around them. So, in this poem, we've got these three elements. We've got the enthusiastic structure. We've got the alliteration, which is most definitely not accidental. And then we've got this rhetorical question that ends. Now again, I want to emphasize that all three of these devices are designed so that the reader doesn't just read it and the eyes follow the page and move on to the next thing. It's designed so that the reader reads it and goes back into it. Oh, look at that rhetorical repetition. Something must be going on. I better go back and look. Oh, it ends with this very interesting question. Something must be going on. I must go back and look and figure it out. And this is what we, as analysts of literature, as people who appreciate poetry, this is what we are supposed to do. This is how we are supposed to be affected by this poem. So that's it. Thank you very much.